Coming to the first and the most important pneumoconiosis, silicosis. Silicosis, as we saw, is caused because of the silica dust. The industries which are involved with silicosis are mining, pottery, ceramic, gold, silver, coal, lead, zinc, manganese, a lot of metals, building, construction, sand blasting, rock mining, iron and steel industry. So anywhere basically you have a blast, you have sand, you have particulate pollutants and pottery, these kinds of industries are all prone to silicosis. In fact, this disease was first notified in the India in the gold mines, in the Kolar gold mines. So that is where this disease was very much common. In some populations, this disease is as common as 30%. That is a very big number to have. So silicosis is probably the most important pneumoconiosis, and a lot of people are getting affected because of silicosis also. The pathology that silicosis has is dense nodular fibrosis. I am not a pathologist, but I try to explain what happens. What happens is you have these silica particles coming in. As I told you, these are inorganic particles. We do not have any machinery to deal with them. We cannot dissolve them. We cannot take them out. So the body, what it does is it loculates these particles, and these macrophages die around these particles, and then some of them travel back. What happens is ultimately these lymphatic channels which are going to the hilar lymph nodes get blocked. So you have this hilar lymphadenopathy and you have multiple lesions in the lung. So you have a collection of small nodules, 3 to 4 millimeter nodules on the Roentgenogram, which is fancy word for saying x-rays. So you have these fine nodules on x-rays and you have dense nodular fibrosis, plus you have this hilar nodular enlargement because of the macrophages which were on their way going to the hilar nodes and they died midway. The onset is clinically insidious. Impairment of total lung capacity is observed and it is a initial symptom. These nodules, like tuberculosis, are found majority of the times at the apex of the lung or the lower lobes or the upper lobes of the lung. So these nodules are found basically in the upper lobes, and therefore this picture looks very much like tuberculosis. In fact, we will see that silicosis and tuberculosis are so similar in picture that they almost mimic each other. There was a condition which was called as silicotuberculosis, which is doubtful recently, but silicotuberculosis was a hypothesis that patients of silicosis are at an increased predisposition to develop tuberculosis. However, evidence does not prove that, and therefore this is still a gray area. But the point to remember is, in reactivation of tuberculosis, you have lesions which are basically at the upper lobes. Similarly, silicotuberculosis has. You may have hilar lymphadenopathy. Here also you have hilar lymphadenopathy. So clinically, radiologically, it looks very much similar. Tuberculosis and silicosis look very much similar. As I told, the onset is insidious and slowly you have deteriorating pulmonary function tests. X-ray shows a snowstorm appearance. So this is so catchy, so pathognomonic that they don't use it nowadays. But still you should know, X-ray for a patient of silicosis looks a snowstorm appearance. Slowly what happens, these densities grow and you have them so often that they simply hazes out. Everything is merged and it looks like you have a snowstorm there. You have some nodules interspersed here and there, and there are these shadows of those blocked lymphatic channels plus those hilar lymph nodes. So everything looks like very snowy, the lung fields are not at all clear, and then we call it as a snowstorm appearance. So snowstorm appearance is seen in silicosis. As I told, there is a condition called as silicotuberculosis, but no tuberculi found in these lesions, and the postmortem also did not show any tuberculosis. So it still remains to be seen whether they are really associated or not, but we would tend to believe that silicotics would be prone for tuberculosis. There is no effective treatment for silicosis, as you know that it is a fibrotic disease. There are huge bands of fibrous tissue formed on both the sides. The whole lymphatic channel gets fibrous. There is lymphadenopathy, hilar lymphadenopathy, and since it is fibrosis, by your basic knowledge you know that fibrosis is irreversible. Once there is fibrosis, there is nothing that we can do about it. Silicosis, by the time it is manifest, has got fibrotic changes, and therefore there is no treatment for reversal of silicosis. Therefore, what we have basically, the tenets of prevention are control, and control is done by dust control measures, which are substitution, complete enclosure, isolation, hydroblasting, good housekeeping, and the use of personal protective measures. Substitution, as you already know, is abandoning the use of silica. Rather than having an exposure to silica, if some other substitute is available, that should be used. Complete exposure is when you blast something, that blast area, or when you have grinding something, that grinding area should be isolated so that those dust particles don't blow out and you don't inhale them. Similarly, hydroblasting is having water nearby so that the dust particles are absorbed by the water and they don't come to the employees. Personal protective measures, you can have respirators, you can have filters so that those dust particles get entrapped into those filters and don't reach the lung. Again, what was the size of the particles which reached the alveoli? It was less than 5 microns. It was less than 5 microns. Regular physical examination of the workers is warranted. If somebody has chest symptoms, he should be moved out of the job. He should be given some other job if he has developed chest symptoms. Silicosis was made a notifiable disease under the Factories Act and the Mines Act. No doubt silicosis is so important, it is so rampant, it is a notifiable disease. Coming to the second disease, we have anthracosis. Before going there, just a small bit about silicosis. This picture also looks like acute proteolysis in the lung. So sometimes that is also asked. This picture clinically also looks like a lot of other conditions. So you should know. Also, silicosis is a condition which I already told you in the last class, can develop very rapidly if the exposure is very, very high. Usually it is insidious in onset, but if the exposure is very high, the dust concentration in the air is too much, silicosis can develop fast. Coming to anthracosis. Anthracosis, I hope you remember, is caused by coal dust. So when we talk about coal dust, we are talking about anthracosis. It is seen in the coal mining industry. There are two types of anthracosis: simple pneumoconiosis, and the dangerous one is the progressive massive fibrosis. So you have two types of anthracosis. One is simple and the other is PMF, or progressive massive fibrosis. Let me write that down on the board. Now the bad news here is, once simple pneumoconiosis develops, it automatically relegates to progressive massive fibrosis. So many a times, if you have development of simple pneumoconiosis, patient leaves the job, goes to his house. After a couple of years, still he may land up with progressive massive fibrosis. So that is the bad news. If you have left the job, exposure has stopped, still simple pneumoconiosis in anthracosis can progress to progressive massive fibrosis. And progressive massive fibrosis is a very dangerous condition to have. PMF is a serious respiratory disability. It can cause premature death and it develops without further exposure after simple pneumoconiosis, like I told. So this is a roller coaster ride. Once you get on it, there is no getting off it. If you have simple pneumoconiosis, it can develop. Remember that. Anthracosis is also a notifiable disease in the Indian Mines Act and is also compensable as per the Workmen's Compensation Act. Vicinosis. Vicinosis, as you saw, is seen in cotton fiber dust. If you have ever been to a cotton industry, you see that there are shreds of cotton spread everywhere. The whole air is filled with shreds of cotton, and therefore it is very easy to inhale those cotton birds. Everybody looks like a Santa there. You have all cotton sticking everywhere out of the body. So that is why vicinosis is common. India has a huge industry, and most of the industry is textile industry. So you can imagine the burden of vicinosis that we might be having. Vicinosis therefore assumes massive importance, because most of the industrial output of India is called the cotton industry, and vicinosis is a disease which happens with cotton workers. It causes progressive dyspnea. Initially it is insidious in onset, causes progressive dyspnea, there is worsening of the pulmonary function test, and ultimately you have chronic bronchitis and emphysema. So the clinical features of chronic bronchitis and emphysema you will also have with vicinosis. Bagasosis. Bagas was, you get a jute bag that was made up of the sugar cane. So sugar cane dust. Sugarcane dust, which is used in paper, cardboard and rayon industry, this is the culprit for bagasosis. The actual constituent which causes bagasosis is thought to be this actinomyces saccharin. This is an actinomyces by the name of thermoactinomyces saccharin, which is thought to be the culprit which causes bagasosis. This name therefore is important. This is again an exception. You have an actinomyces which is thought to be the agent of a pneumoconiosis. So therefore, since it is an exception, it becomes important. The name is again thermoactinomyces saccharin. What happens in bagasosis is that you have breathlessness, you have cough and you have hemoptysis. So it looks infectious. Cough, hemoptysis, breathlessness looks infectious. You should suspect that it is bagasosis. It can also cause acute bronchiolitis. Skiagram, that is again x-ray, shows mottling, or it can also show shadow, so that is non-consistent. If treated early, the resolution of acute inflammatory condition occurs. Again an exception. Here we have a disease which can be treated, bagasosis. If left untreated, bagasosis causes diffuse fibrosis, emphysema, and ultimately it leads to bronchiectasis. So it is going down like the other ones we discussed. Prevention of bagasosis. You should have dust control measures. We saw isolation and personal protective equipments. Personal protective measures are here. Medical control. You should have regular follow-up of the workers so that if they have these chest symptoms, you can monitor them. And bagasse control, probably the most important, because we have something substantial here. What do we have? You have to keep the moisture content above 20% to prevent dust formation. If the moisture content is above 20%, automatically the dust formation will come down. And what you can do is, you can also spray the bagasse with 2% propionic acid, which is a fungicide. So it will keep thermoactinomyces saccharin under control. 2% propionic acid is sprayed and moisture content is kept above 20% so that dust is not formed. So these are two specific measures for bagasosis. Again, because it is an infectious etiology in a pneumoconiosis, we have a specific therapy for it or a control measure for it. It has importance. So that was bagasosis. The next disease, a massive one, asbestosis. We already had seen a couple of classes earlier that asbestosis is a killer disease and it is caused by very commonly used asbestos. That corrugated sheet that you have of white colored over the houses, many houses would still have that. That is asbestos. You have asbestos doors, you have asbestos roofs, brake linings. It is used in fire equipment. It is used in a lot of industries. So asbestos was once upon a time widely used. It's still used in asbestos cement, textile industries, roof tiling, brake lining and gaskets. So a lot of use. Plus, if you remember, we had talked about a particular state where asbestosis was very common. And which was that state? If you said Gujarat, good. Gujarat has a shipwrecking industry and a lot of asbestosis liberated there and many people get asbestosis. So the types of asbestos. There are basically two types of asbestos that you need to know. The first one is the serpentine variety and the second one is the amphibole. So these are the two types of asbestos. Serpentine asbestos, as the name suggests, the particle look like this. Serpentine variety asbestos looks like this microscopically. And for the amphibole variety, they are needle shaped crystals. So if I have to draw a rough diagram, maybe something like this. So they are needle shaped, that is amphibole. Serpentine, because they are twisted, it is more likely that they get trapped into the natural defense mechanisms and thus they don't reach the alveoli. Because amphibole is straight, he has a direct access to the alveoli. So when you inhale, those particles directly bypass your natural defenses and they land up in the alveoli. So this is dangerous then. Okay, serpentine is not that dangerous, but the amphibole variety is dangerous. Probably an exception where a straight guy is more dangerous because it goes straight to the alveoli. Asbestos is notorious for a lot of things, but it causes some serious conditions. One of those conditions you should never forget are sitting duck MCQs if you are lucky enough to have a straight question is mesothelioma. it causes mesothelioma. Now, mesothelioma is an interesting guy. As it is, mesothelioma is a very rare tumor. Have you ever heard tumor about the pleura or the peritoneum? Never. This is the first time that you hear that the peritoneum or the pleura is developing a tumor. And if you have heard this, asbestosis is the cause. It is so often associated with asbestosis that if you have mesothelioma, automatically what should strike in your head is, okay, I have asbestos somewhere here. If you hear mesothelioma, suspect asbestos. So the association is that strong. And it can also cause a number of other cancers. It can cause lung cancer, it can cause stomach cancer, it can cause colon cancer. So it can cause a lot of other cancers. But the most specific is mesothelioma. I am not saying the most common, I am saying the most specific. There is a difference. Mesothelioma is the most specific cancer for asbestosis. So as you saw, causes mesothelioma of pleura and also the peritoneum, and it is wonderful how it goes to the peritoneum, because to my knowledge I have, these are two separate cavities, so it can cause colon cancer also for that matter, again, which is surprising. So remember, asbestos causes cancers at a number of surprising places. It can cause the cancer of the GIT, and cigarette smoking increases incidence. So we have a synergistic association with cigarette smoking. By the way, that brings me to an important topic. The synergistic association between cigarette smoking and asbestos is found in lung cancer. It is not found in mesothelioma. This is a very finer point, and therefore this has not been tested, but it is liable to be tested because it is very fine. If you, like you say, split the hair, cigarette smoking is synergistic with asbestosis for lung cancer. It is not synergistic for mesothelioma. Cigarette smoking does not affect mesothelioma. Asbestosis affects mesothelioma. So there is a fine difference here, and I hope you appreciate it now. Clinical features of asbestosis: causes clubbing. Okay, those Chamberlain sign, clinical medicine, the window closes. You have cardiac distress and you have cyanosis. There are asbestos bodies in sputum. Now what are these asbestos bodies? Asbestos bodies are nothing but these amphibole and or javans or warriors, those macrophages, they cover it completely and these guys die and the whole thing comes out. So that is what asbestos bodies is. Microscopically it can be seen, sometimes the fiber is also seen, and you have a lot of macrophages surrounding it with some fibrinous material. That is an asbestos body. Fortunately, you don't have some fancy name for it, otherwise we'll have to remember a new name. It itself says asbestos bodies. So I don't think that it would be a problem for you to recognize that it is caused because of asbestos. You also have diffuse peribronchial infiltration plus basal lesions in contrast to silicosis. Remember, I had drawn the lung diagram. I said you have up, the lesions are up, but here the lesions are not up. Let me draw that. We will draw two lungs. Now this is a very crude diagram. A lung probably looks much better. What I had told you is that you have basically lesions here in silicosis, and in asbestosis there are basal lesions, and therefore the lesions would be predominantly here. This is again an important feature to differentiate. If in the stem of the question it is mentioned that there were basal lesions or there were apical lesions, they are basically giving you on a platter that, okay, basal lesions, I am talking about asbestosis, and if I have apical lesions, I was talking about silicosis. So there is diffuse peribronchial lesions and there are basal lesions in contrast to silicosis, where the lesions were nodular and apical. So you have nodules here in silicosis, and again, by your knowledge of radiology, maybe you know that these diffuse peribronchial lesions would not look like nodules. They would look like a hyaline deposit. Okay, so you have a more or less uniform opacity here, and it is more concentrated on the basal side. Here I have these nodular lesions, I have a snowstorm appearance, I have involvement of the hilar lymph nodes, that is silicosis. So you can have a comparison here between the silicotic lung and an asbestosis lung. X-ray shows ground glass appearance, the appearance that I was talking about. So you have a more or less ground glass appearance. That means like what I had drawn here. This appearance is what is a ground glass appearance. And this is a nodular one. Prevention. Prevention, you have substitution. You have safer types like the chrysolite and the amosite. Now this chrysolite amosite are also the same thing. They are asbestos, but they are the safer versions. Substitution, you can have glass to be used. You can have fiber, you can have wool, you can have plastics. Nowadays plastics are the wonderful substances which are replacing a lot of other things, and asbestos is one of them, which is losing its job because of plastics. You can have dust control where asbestos is used, periodic medical examination of persons exposed to the risk of asbestos, and continual medical research for further substitution and amelioration of the problem. So that was a very important disease, asbestosis. We have covered many pneumoconiosis, and the one that is remaining will be covered in the next class. Thank you.